Hi, folks. Welcome to the Great Conversations podcast. I'm your host, Calvin Smith, and this is where we discuss five big topics: the gospel, relevance, evangelism, apologetics, and training for Christians, all in relation to the truth of God's word in Genesis as the seedbed for all Christian doctrines. And what we're going to be covering here today is the concept of date doctoring and why you can trust the Bible's timeline versus the radiometric dating methods that we so often hear about that people use to attempt to undermine the trustworthiness of the Bible's timeline. Sir Isaac Newton famously said, "Atheism is so senseless and odious to mankind that it never had many professors." Now, unlike today, where you can practically trip over three atheists, you know, just on your way to the supermarket. At the time when Sir Isaac Newton penned this, who, by the way, he's often quoted as the most famous and influential scientist who's ever lived. At the time Newton penned this in the mid-1600s, it was a very true statement. You see, when you think about the concept of atheism as a whole, a system of belief where practically everything is meaningless because our very existence is thought to have been brought about with no purpose or direction, it is an extremely odious concept because there can't be any true meaning to anything at all. You see, in this worldview, someday you and I will die, our kids will die, their kids will die, and eventually the whole universe will reach heat death and die. And no one will ever remember any of our relationships, accomplishments, hopes, dreams, discoveries, and everything that ever happened, or ultimately, everything will be for nothing. However, for the unrepentant sinner, there is kind of a silver lining behind this worldview. It's the assumption that there's no judgment. You see, a moral law requires a moral lawgiver. And with the concept that there is no God comes the freedom of belief that no matter what we do in life, no matter how, you know, evil our thoughts and deeds, if we are somehow able to get away with it, then we actually get away with it. So as long as you just concentrate on the good part, so to speak, you can swallow this bitter pill of atheism with the honey of non-accountability quite smoothly. It's kind of like putting lipstick on a pig, you know. It might look a little better, but it's going to stink just as bad. But so similarly, to the example of getting children to take something they wouldn't normally want, you know, a little bit of sugar. Secular thinkers in the 1800s understood that in order to sway people over to accept their naturalistic worldview, they'd need to dress it up a bit and make it more feasible and more attractive. I mean, after all, sin-cursed people are inborn with a sin nature, a proclivity to reject the things of God. So enticing them with an atheistic outlook wouldn't be that hard if an intellectually acceptable way to lead them towards that conclusion, you know, could be brought to back it up. Now, think this through. In order for someone to accept atheism, they've got to believe that everything they see around them has somehow come about by random processes. And in order to replace the idea for a creator God, in order for that to have happened, it's reasonable to assume that the universe just didn't pop into existence fully formed and functional the way that we experience it today. So the concept of millions of years of Earth history being a fact was crucial in establishing a naturalistic worldview among the populace in the West. Kind of like an image consultant or a date doctor whose job it is to help their clients look their best while hiding their worst features. The concept of long ages was popularized by emphasizing its supposed, you know, kind of innocuous effect on the dominant Christian worldview of the day, highlighting its so-called scientific attributes and wrapping it all in a veneer of intellectual credibility. Although this stood against the commonly accepted belief that the Bible's timeline of approximately 6,000 years was true, the concept of long ages gradually made inroads against that understanding, often with help from those within the church itself, quite rapidly. And although initially being introduced through the idea of rock layers supposedly forming slowly layer by layer, Today, the majority of people assume that the Earth is billions of years old, often because they think that dating methods like radioisotope or radiometric calculations, well, they're foolproof. Radiometric dating was developed in the early 20th century, and it's considered by mainstream scientists and laypersons alike as very reliable for measuring absolute ages of rocks and hence the Earth. But is there really a reliable direct way to determine the absolute age of any fossil or rock or the Earth? Well, contrary to the widespread belief that there is, actually no such method exists. I mean, if you closely examine specific examples of dating by this method, its proven validity falls apart really quickly. There is, in fact, no way to directly determine the age of any fossil or rock. Now, if you think that's overstating, consider this. For example, the revised age of the Earth, according to the latest radioactive dating, is 4.55 billion and 4.6 billion years old. Now, that alone represents a considerable gap of 50 million years. It isn't an absolute age for the Earth at all. And although some may see this fudge factor as acceptable to the big picture, it can make the astute thinker realize there's legitimate room for real doubt regarding these methods. Unfortunately, evolutionary scientists, including old Earth Christian geologists, fully embrace these methods like VARV or tree ring chronology and carbon dating as proven dating methods, but often ignore the glaring but often little known weaknesses that these methods have. So let's look at how all of this works. You see, some types of rocks, particularly igneous rocks that are formed from magma, contain radioactive isotopes of certain elements. And in some cases, isotopes can be unstable or radioactive, and they're called parent isotopes. And they're assumed to decay at a consistent rate into a stable isotope or a new element called daughter isotopes. So scientists can measure the ratio of the parent isotopes and their daughter isotopes in the rocks with a great degree of accuracy. No one's denying that. And this gives scientists a way to calculate what's called half-life, or the time required for one half of the amount of unstable material to degrade into a more stable material. Now, although the length of the half-life is different for every radioisotope, the half-life pattern is the same. So in other words, the less of the parent isotope and the more of the daughter isotope that we measure in a specimen, the older we assume it to be. Now, by assuming the starting amount, how long it takes for the material to decay, and how much is present in the sample being examined, this provides a way for scientists to assume how old a material is. However, it's important to understand something. Rocks aren't clocks. What they're measuring is not an absolute dates here, hence the range and the supposed age of the Earth, but they're measuring ratios, and the dates have to be inferred based on assumptions about those ratios. So it's vital to understand that the assumptions about the facts that we observe, the rocks and fossils, rather than the facts themselves, are the key to how these dating methods operate, since we're not able to go back in time and witness rocks or fossils being formed, or see the decay rates of the atoms at the time when the Earth was created. We need to understand that scientists need to make assumptions in order to predict the age of a fossil or rock sample. Again, since radiometric dating measures the rate of radioactive decay, one of the assumptions scientists make is the amount of the initial parent or daughter isotopes in the rock, as they weren't present in the past to measure it. Now, I'm not criticizing the logic behind these dating methods, but what we need to realize is the assumptions applied to that logic and how it can cause faulty conclusions. And to see what types of assumptions are at play when using these types of dating methods, a simple analogy of a burning candle will help us to do so. So follow along here. Trying to determine the age of a candle by measuring its burning rate and height will serve as an analogy here to understand how geologists calculate a sample rock age. Okay, so pretend you want to know how quickly a normal wax candle will burn away, decay, so to speak. So you set up an experiment, You've got a candle, it's 12 inches high, and you light it. Now, let's say for our analogy that we notice that every hour, okay, on the clock, 1 inch of the candle melts away. So after 2 hours, the candle is only 10 inches tall. And after 4 hours, the candle is only 8 inches tall. So from the data you've collected, you determine that the decay rate of the candle is in fact 1 inch per hour. It's all very logical, all very reasonable. Now, let's say you walk into a room. Now you've never been in the room before. And you see a burning candle and it's 6 inches tall. Can you assume that you can know how long it's been burning? I mean, most people would say, yeah, based on the data collected earlier, that yes, you can know with confidence that the candle has been burning for 6 hours. I mean, you got a starting height of 12 inches, a decay rate of 1 inch per hour. Well, that equals a height of 6 inches and 6 hours passed, right? But what if the candle was initially 16 inches tall? I mean, we never observed its starting condition. What if the candle had been lit 10 years ago, burned for a little while, then someone snuffed it out, and it had been relit just 5 minutes before you walked into the room? I mean, we weren't able to observe the processes that brought it to the state. I mean, what if, unlike your experiment, someone had opened up a window in this room and a breeze had been blowing on the candle, making it burn faster than what you observed in your experiment? I mean, you don't know what specific factors may have influenced the result you're seeing. Can you see how we might think that we can calculate that the rate at which the wax is melting now and the amount of wax that has dripped, then we can go backwards and measure how long the candle has been burning are based on assumptions? Our assumptions may be reasonable, logical, scientific, based on careful observations and measurements, but our conclusions could be wildly incorrect. Those calculations could only be accurate if we knew and received data from a trusted source or someone who observed the candle before it started burning and all the way through the process. So similar assumptions used in the candle analogy apply to all radiometric dating methods. One, you must first know the starting amount of the parent isotope at the beginning of the specimen's existence. Two, you must be certain that there was no daughter isotopes present in the beginning. Three, you must be certain that neither parent nor daughter isotopes have ever been added or removed from the specimen. And four, you must be certain that the decay rate of a parent isotope to daughter isotope has always been the same. However, just like the burning candle, if the set of assumptions is incorrect, then the resulting ages using those studies are also incorrect. It's true that we can measure decay rates using observational science, but these dating methods must assume certain things that supposedly occurred in the past, which can't be repeated or tested. Now, although some people simply trust that the assumptions are correct, the chances of at least one of these four assumptions being invalid is made very obvious when we look at some of the published radiometric dates found in the scientific literature. Because around the world, a number of studies have been done to try to validate radiometric dating, but have failed. For example, rocks of a known age from observed events like Mount St. Helens last eruption in 1986 have been tested. And several different radiometric dating methods used resulted in dates estimated at millions of years when we know that the rock was only 10 years old when tested through radiometric dating. Also, the north rim of the Grand Canyon, well, it's got lava flows from volcanoes on it that erupted after its formation, which potassium-argon dating methods have determined are a billion years older than the oldest rocks at the bottom of the canyon are supposed to be. Another example, near Hawaii, lava from underwater volcanoes known to have erupted in 1801 AD has given dates varying between 160 million years up to 3 billion years old, which is an incredible difference for what many people consider as so-called reliable methods. So the point being this, If you can't trust these dating methods with rocks you do know the age of, why would you trust them with rocks you don't know the age of? Especially considering the huge number of unproven assumptions that go into the methodology behind them. And by the way, it should be obvious that in a brief broadcast like this, we can only touch on a few examples and are just talking about some overarching principles involved. So if you want more detailed information about radiometric dating, go to the answersingenesis.ca website for a ton of in-depth scientific articles from PhD geologists from a wide range of backgrounds that can help you dig into the nitty-gritty of this in more detail. The big picture is this. Secular humanism, founded on the declaration that there is no need to believe in a creator God because of the story of evolution, is now the dominant force in progressive minds shaping our society. And this ideology all rests on the undergirding belief in supposed millions of years of Earth history as fact, and radiometric dating is certainly a linchpin of that platform of thought. Unfortunately, many Christian scientists and laypersons alike today continue to choose this path of conformity to what secular science has been dictating, wrongly assuming that the grand scope of evolutionary thought is truth and that specific and plainly read truths presented in the Bible are not to be taken literally. And this has conceded biblical authority and granted it to the secular forces who've used that to take control of Western society. You know, by controlling the education and media of the day to impose these ideas to the masses, well, we can sum it up this way. He who controls the present controls the past, and he who controls the past controls the future. Christians need to learn and to teach their children and the world around them that these date doctors of the day who promote these so-called scientific dating methods don't trump the revealed word of God. So rather than just trust the false conclusions based on the supposed age of rocks we see around us, we should continue to put our trust in the Rock of Ages. If you're appreciating this content, please visit the answersingenesis.ca website and consider donating to the ministry. And of course, whatever platform you're accessing this on most likely has some kind of combination of features that allow you to subscribe or like or share or perhaps do a review. And we'd appreciate you taking the time to do so because it's probably the most effective thing that you can do to help us continue to do outreach. So until next time, I'm Cal Smith. Blessings to you and yours.